All right, what's happening, everybody, man? Thank you guys for tuning in to, episode 81 of Expert Mentors Live. Super excited for today's episode. We've got Tina Call on, and we're going to talk a little bit about how to go from zero to 50 deals in 1 year, answer any questions, any comments, anything that you guys have. So if you're on live with us, throw it into the chat in the Q&A. If you're tuning in, throw it into the Facebook comments, and we'll definitely get everything answered for you. So, Tina, say hello to the Honey Badger Nation.
Hello, Honey Badger Nation. Excited to be here.
I'm excited to have you on. I know we've been trying to make this happen, and I know today is going to be a great episode.
That's right.
Hey, before we jump in, I know we've got a lot of new Honey Badgers, and they might not just be quite aware of what Expert Mentors Live is really all about. And as you can, as we said, this is episode 81, and what it was designed for was being able to tap into the horsepower of the Honey Badger Nation with amazing people like Tina and so many others that are a part of this incredible organization. So we do these every Wednesday at noon central. So lock them into your calendar and make sure you guys tune in.
Yep. I learn a lot from them myself. So
awesome. Absolutely. So cool. So Tina, give us a little history, a little story about you, kind of bring everybody up to speed. And then let's get into today's topic.
Sure. So I started real estate when I was 23. I actually was in college for a couple of years. Didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. And my husband and I bought a house, we flipped it, we made money, and I was like, that was fun, so let's keep doing that. So I was in Michigan at the time. I stayed there for about 6-7 years. Kevin and I couldn't stand the snow anymore. And again, everybody says, what's your why and your big why? Well, for us, it was never money, it was lifestyle. So we decided to pack our son up, 4 years old, and we headed out to down to North Carolina in 2009. So we got here and we didn't know a soul. So for me, it's like it was two careers. It was this 10-year track. And I came down, I didn't know a soul. And luckily for me, I had just hired a coaching company. And we got here and we got on the phones and we got really good at expireds and for sale by owners. And never looked back. So we grew the business. Our first year, I think it was like 37 deals to 40 deals to 60 deals to 100. And then 130 was my breaking point. It was myself, my husband, and an admin. And so then I started hiring some buyer agents. I think our best and most fun year was two buyer agents, myself, and then two admins. So there were five people and we did about 175 transactions. It was a very profitable year. I bought a lake house and then I grew a team.
There you go.
And that was fun. No, I'm just kidding. And so now I have a great team. So I moved into team leadership. I'm still selling about 100 homes a year, trying to figure out the next step, the next phase. But I have 10 great people on my team. We coach them every day and we never look back. So we'll do about 300 transactions this year, just over $102 million in volume.
That's awesome. That is incredible. Yeah. Congrats on that. And I know you're probably going to get into it. I just, when you jumped into the new market, going right after that low hanging fruit, was there any kind of mental battles there? Was like, okay, this is just what we do.
No, my gosh, no. Because, I think that real estate for me is always, it's a head game, right? So my coaches would say, the people the list of people is going to be smaller than the list of people you don't know. Well, obviously I moved into a new market. I didn't know anyone. So we were forced to learn scripts and just get on the phones because we needed business. We needed money quickly. And so it was a constant head game of, how do I convince myself to get on the phone and get rejected? And any logical person will know that no matter what you do, at some point you're going to run into a grumpy seller, right. You call them once or 52 times. So I had to just consistently play that psychological, you can do this, just get back in there again. I think that was it for us in the beginning, is staying consistent and embracing repetitious boredom. And then, you know, as we were embracing that boredom and being on the phones, we were getting better and better with our skills, with our script pack practice. So really the beginning was just doing it, doing something.
Was it helpful that, that you had Kevin there with you to kind of push through and do it together?
Yes. In fact, we always laugh. We fought about who was going to prospect more that day. I don't recommend it for a marriage. You do not move out of state and then, you know, you and your spouse have to get on the phone and prospect to make money. It's not healthy. So we would get in there. We would make this special tea called Kava tea. We both hate it to this day. We hate the CD that we would play, you know, doing our calling. But, you know, it did help when I was down and I was defeated. He would get an appointment. And then when he was feeling down and defeated, I would get an appointment. So we could balance the mental game, I guess, of defeat and push each other. So it was good.
That's awesome. That is awesome.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think, it, you know, telling your story really ties into what today's topic is about. And I'm sure, you know, you've taken your experience in that framework to, like you said, coach your team. Mm-hmm. I would just love to kind of jump in and let's work through that the whole trajectory and the program and the process that you take everybody through.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think the first thing is, you know, if we have somebody brand new on our team, they need to understand that when they know what to say, you know, they're going to feel more confident. And I think we all know sales is a confidence game, right? So it's almost to become script masters. So we try to get them chanting their scripts out loud at a high speed, right? Role playing with partners so they know, you know, kind of how it should sound. Recording their scripts and then listening to them back, which, you know, is never fun. Who likes to hear themselves talk? But I think the first phase is mastering memorization, like mastering the memorization of the script, and then internalizing the script is phase two. And then phase three is putting your own personal touch on it. So in the beginning, people go, oh, this is weird, this is not me. Well, we don't care if it's you or not, we just want you to know what to say. And then when you know what to say, and you can internalize it when you're sitting in front of a seller or a buyer, you're not gonna be worried about what I'm saying. And then finally, again, that last phase is, oh, okay, now I know what to say. So I can be Tina, I can be John, I can be Kevin. So that's our first goal, is just to get them learning their scripts.
Right. I love that. And is that an ongoing thing? What's the time frame that you want to bring it up? What's the frequency? Are they doing it every day? What's
daily.
Going on?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I've been with a coaching company for the last 11 years and it's a daily grind. Like it's, you know, you think of a basketball player. They're not going to just learn how to play basketball and never practice, right?
Right.
So here we are in an environment where, you know, a seller may pay us $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 to sell their home. Why would we stop practicing? You know, and I think that, you know, for us, it was get into the office at the same time. I had 5 role play partners. So a new role play partner each day. So that way I was very versatile in personality style. So I had an analytical, I had a driver, I had an expressive, and I would learn the different versatility styles. So that was daily. And then it's, you know, coming in at 8 and then psyching yourself up to get on the phones and getting all that little drunk monkey language out of your mind, which is, oh God, is it too early to call? Am I calling these people too much? Is someone going to hang up on me today? I mean, we've all been through it, right?
Sure.
But I think it's just, it's getting on the phone. And then the minute you're off the call, it's the time between that second call that's key. You know, a lot of us might do it once and then it's, oh my God, I'm telling a story in my head about the next call and why I shouldn't. And I think if salespeople just understood, they just get back on doing it, just get back on the phones. You're going to have so much more success if you can block out those negative, you know, stories that we tell ourselves. It really is a story.
That's a great point. You know, I always, we used to joke and laugh with some of our ISAs that would be high eyes, right? They would set an appointment, then they'd have to go tell everybody in the whole office.
Yes, yes.
Like, what are you doing?
Hey. Yeah, we have a bell, you know, you ring the bell when you make an appointment and it's exciting, but you know, to me, it's like, I could make 3 appointments. I might cancel all 3, you know, it just an appointment's an appointment, but it's not a listing. It's not a sale.
Right.
So yeah, keep that consistency of, every day I'm a skilled salesperson. I'm going to get to the office at the same time. I'm going to treat it like a job. I'm going to get my butt on the phones. I'm going to overcome the craziness that happens, you know, between our ears every single day. Mastering conversations with sellers. You know, there's only certain things sellers say and certain things buyers say. They don't reinvent the wheel. They don't have masterminds on how they can get us and stump us. They say the same thing. So learn what to say, and therefore you'll be successful.
That's great. You know, you coming in with the team and role playing, what would you say to somebody that it's just them, right? You know, they didn't have a Kevin right beside them to be able to kind of go through this. What would you recommend from a role play perspective to really be able to practice daily?
Well, I mean, when I think about our life before, I mean, Kevin wasn't right there. I was the realtor. He moved here. He was moved from another sales career. So he would always say, I'm the show. Why would they send him when they could send me? So I was already a realtor for 9 years. Therefore, I was the one that got into the office and did the role plays and worked on the skill part. So I didn't have him there kind of pushing me to let's learn this together. We each learned at our own pace with other role play partners. So I think, again, if you're going to be persistent and you're going to be successful, you have to have some sort of internal driver to get you to do those things. And if you don't have them, if you're not self-driven, then you need to put accountability in place and get an accountability partner that's going to hold you accountable. So for us, it was, if you don't get on the call, it's $100. So if I missed, you know, four role plays, it was $400 a week. That would hurt at a time when I didn't have it to spend. Right. And now I would have to make that price a little higher. I could go, I'll miss four. It's only $400 because I make more. So now it would have to be, Tina, if you don't show up for this call, it's going to be $1,000. At least make it hurt. So you got to figure out what's going to hurt. And then your accountability partner has to follow through. I was happy to cash checks of the people that failed, and they cashed mine. And we cashed a lot of each other's. Sure. But we, even though we spent thousands of dollars probably in that 10-year period failing, we made money. You know, we made a lot of money. So, I think it's holding yourself accountable to do those things.
Yeah, no, I love it. It's fantastic creating that pain that definitely will get your attention for sure. Mm-hmm. I asked, how did you guys choose the market that you moved down into?
It was funny because we went to Virginia, we went to Cary, North Carolina, because it was on, I think, Money Magazine's top 10 places to live. Yep. My father lived in Florida, so we visited Florida. Just when we flew into this area, and it was just, you know, really dense with trees are green. It was just so beautiful and green, you know, this canopy green that it felt like home. And so the neat thing was we picked the right area for us at the time. We didn't know the economy was tanking all around. So in Michigan, 2006, you know, we were losing half of our value. Yep. It just started to affect North Carolina. So we actually came into a market that started to decline. And I have to say, I think that was luck, because the opportunity that presented for me, a skilled agent to come into a market where more and more agents are leaving the business, more and more sellers need help. They need to have those awful conversations about, hey, you're going to owe money when you leave this property. It's not going to be fun, but at least I can get you out of it. I think it was a blessing that we actually were in a healthy market, but that just started declining versus a market that had already crashed.
Right.
So yeah, we just picked it by feel, I guess.
That's awesome. Yeah. No, I wanted to ask you that because I know, you know, there's other people out there, you know, thinking I would love to make a move, but I'm not, you know, I can't make a move. And it's like, yeah, you can. You can absolutely do it.
You can absolutely do it. And, it was just real quick. It was funny. When we made the move, there was an agent in Michigan that had been in the same coaching company. And he moved down here about a year and a half before we did. And so I would call him periodically. I'm like, hey, how you doing down there? He's like, oh, it's okay. He was hardly selling anything. And so Kevin would say, hey, how's so-and-so doing? I'm like, oh, he's crushing it. He's killing it down there. Like he, you know, because I'm thinking I can't depend on what this one guy is doing and live my life around. So I lied to Kevin completely. I'm like, he is crushing it down there. you know, he didn't know, but obviously when we got here, he was like, he did not crush it. He failed. He actually left the business. So, again, you can't depend on other people's, lives and their success or their failures to, follow in their path. You're going to make your own path. So.
Right. Absolutely. No, I love that. So you kind of got into a little bit of, you mentioned about getting into the office. What type of schedule throughout the week, throughout the day, have you guys, are you trying to get your team as well as yourselves to really be the most productive?
So I think for us, it's getting, eating the frog first, we say. So get in there in the morning when you're fresh, when you're ready to go, and, get on the phones or do whatever prospecting that you want. It doesn't have to be expireds and physicals. It has to be whatever your prospecting method is, whether it's knocking on doors, just get it out of the way in the morning. So from 8 to 11, we like to call that, wealth building time. And that's when truly your why, not your family and all that. We all know our why is our family, but whatever it is that you want to accomplish in life, that has to be big enough to drive you to get through that 8 to 11 hour where you're building your business. And then from 11 to 12, we do lead follow-up time, maybe email time, whatever. 12 to 1, you go to lunch, mindset break. And then from 1 on, I don't care what they do. And I didn't, even for myself, my coach would say, I don't care what you do from 1 on. It's just, if you do the morning right, you're going to have so much business that from 1 to 6, you're going to be going on appointments.
Right.
And that really was true for me then. It's true for us now.
Right. I know that's fantastic. So getting that dialed in, and is it pretty much the same day after day, try to throughout the week?
It's funny because it is. And I think it's consistency. It's coming in, treating it like a job. Like if I said to you, John, I'm going to hire you for my team. And every day you're going to come in at 8, you're going to role play, you're going to get on, you're going to try to make 20 contacts a day, 20 humans. I want to hear their voice. Even if somebody hangs up on you, that's one. So I want you to make 20 contacts a day. I want you to break for lunch. And then after lunch, I want you to go out and meet people or go on appointments. And I'm going to pay you $250,000. That's the job. And then you would say, sure, I'll do it. Most of us don't. Most realtors will not do that. And they want to make all this money, but yet they don't want to embrace the repetitious boredom that it takes to build their business. And so, I think the consistency, the embracing the boredom of the job, because it gets boring. It does to sit on the phones. A lot of realtors are high eyes, so they love to be social creatures. I'm that way too. I used to have my assistant lock me in my office, take my phone, and then when I made my contacts, I could get my phone back. So again, I'm her boss, but yet treat me like, I'm your employee because I need to get this done to keep your job and my job in place.
Making success inevitable, right? You create the conditions that allow success to happen. So it's like everything that you're sharing I love it. Hopefully everybody is picking up on what, the little nuggets that you're dropping is that, you design the environment, the system to ensure your success, right? The practice, the accountability partner, the fee if I don't show up, right? Taking my phone, keeping me locked in the office, knowing yourself, knowing your tendencies, knowing your habits, but making sure that those habits align to the results that you're after. That's fantastic. Yeah. So from a coaching that you guys do with your team on the mindset side of things, is that the mindset you're trying to instill is embrace the boredom, focus on consistency?
Yeah. I mean, it's getting them to, I think for me, it's permission for them to think bigger. So anytime I bring a new member onto the team, when you sit with them and you've probably experienced this, hey, how much money do you want to make? Everyone says 100,000, most everyone. And I think it's because most of us didn't grow up with a silver spoon in our mouth. We didn't grow up in rich families. So making 100 grand used to be a big thing. And, I remember for myself when I was younger, that's what my parents would say. And once I hit 100 grand, I'm like, okay, well now that's it. So what do I do? Just fall into complacency? Well, that's not allowed. And so because of the coaching and the mindset building, it was, don't fall into complacency, push yourself to the next level. What would you do if you made 200 grand? What would you spend the money on if you made 300 grand? How would it feel to make $1 million? So we do a lot of affirmations on our team, getting people in that mindset until they believe it. So at first, when you say, I want to make $1 million. Okay. I know there's a little piece of them in there that goes, man, that's not going to happen. But then 3-4 months in, they start to have these mindset shifts where they go, well, this shit works. This these affirmations are working. They get more excited. They attract more deals, and they're kind of vibrating on a higher frequency, if you will, because all of us have the same collective mindset. Mm-hmm. I had a teacher that my son's teacher actually changed careers. She's probably listening if she is. Hi, Mackenzie. She made 50 grand a year being a teacher. She got onto our team as an admin and she made about the same, but then I could tell she was such a driver, expressive driver, that I knew she wouldn't stay in that role. So she is now in sales. She'll make 110,000 probably in her first year in real estate. But she says, I'm going to make $1 million in real estate. And she finally believes it. And I believe it for her. And it's like the gift for me now is passing along the belief that I got to grow through my coaching and then giving it to these people. So I love to create millionaires. I think that's fun.
That is awesome. That's really, really, really cool. Really powerful. Kind of moving through this and on the growth, coming in, getting to that 50, right? And, mm-hmm. The structure, just even like what, you shared on your guys's growth about year three hit the 60, and obviously being able to learn and get to that 100 where it tips. What, what other key things do we need to focus on, to get us to that first 50?
I think for me, it was always, do something productive every day or try to get that one appointment, whether it's a listing appointment, whether it's go meet a FSBO, go meet a FSBO. And I think they're the easiest way to start. My first three listings in my career were for sale by owners back in, when I was 23 years old. And what did I do? I dropped off information. I went and met with them. I just said, hey, I just want to help you when you're ready. I was there consistently for them and I got my first three listings that way. I was the only face they saw and the only one that didn't give up on them. Now, as I advanced in my career and I didn't have time to babysit for sale by owners, I went right to expireds because to me, they were already there. They raised their hand, they're signed in the yard, they failed. And if I could go in and help them and show them what maybe they missed, I could get the sale faster. So for my agents, I want them to make 5 appointments a week. They're going to cancel 3, go on 2 and take 1. So if I could get every new agent to figure out how do I get one listing or one buyer agency agreement every week, that's their only goal in life. So that's 4 a month. Add up the, 4 times 12, you're going to be at your 50 deals in no time, giving room for some fallout. But, it's that first 90 days of belief where these agents are going, oh my God, I'm grinding. It's not sticking. Well, you're new. Or even if you're not new, you're just getting used to new scripts. So it's that, for me, a real estate career is a 4-year career. Your first year is just like when you're in college. You leave your dorm room and you don't know where your class is. You need the map, right? You're not comfortable. And so you're not going to navigate the real estate world in your first year and be a rock star. I don't care who you are. And then the next year, you're going to go, man, I think I kind of got this. I've got deals under my belt. Your third year, you're going to start feeling like, this is a real career. And your fourth year, you're going to feel like a master of the universe. So you got to give real estate, to me, a 4-year degree. And it really is a process. But it's so worth it because even though it's hard to get started, there's no ceiling. I mean, you could say, I want to make $2 million in real estate. And there's a plan and there's a person out there that's done it. And you can go figure out how.
Yeah, absolutely. Excuse me. So, for somebody that's listening in, that's by themselves, that's trying to get going, maybe, they don't have the confidence, they're getting to that point. What are, they're working through it. At what point do you start creating additional leverage around you? Like, in the beginning, it was you and Kevin. When did you guys pull the trigger on the admin? When did you say, hey, let's reinvest some of these dollars beyond for sub owners and expireds? Kind of what are the next natural, progression for you guys that you added in?
I think, when you're a brand new agent, to me, there's no need to have an assistant until you're doing 30, 40 transactions. That's just me personally, because I just feel like you need to know the process of the deal, number one, the art of putting paperwork together. If you can't do it yourself, and maybe you don't like to do it, you're not going to be able to train somebody else to do it well. So I just, for me, felt like I always wanted to be involved in the beginning, know what I needed to do, and it helped me structure my business. So I think when you get to 30, 40 transactions, 2 to 3 deals a month consistently, fine, hire somebody, because now you can afford to support that person. I was always just a little bit cheaper and I wanted to keep more of the profit. So I would do a little more myself and just block out time. So I wouldn't let, oh my gosh, I have an inspection report to go through. I'm going to do that at 9 a.m. like most of us will want to, because it's creative avoidance. I'll just block off, you know, from 3 to 4 and do those activities and be done. So, yeah, I don't think anybody needs an assistant until they get to that point. And nowadays, which I never had access to, you can do a transaction coordinator or whatever, which is like $250 a deal, and just pass off your deal. And that might be something I would do now.
Right. Absolutely. When do you start looking at, you know, other lead gen sources? You know, what's the natural progression? Do you guys, like, even with the team, I mean, and I guess that's another completely different question, but what is that, that next lead source, you know, FSBOs, expireds, then what for you guys?
I think, you know, leads are everywhere. So I'm big on, you know, if you live in a neighborhood, so I've always said, okay, my last neighborhood, if I sell, you know, 3 homes a year in that neighborhood, it pretty much pays for my mortgage for the year. So I always had our mortgage paid for yearly by the referrals that I did in my own personal neighborhood. So that would be, you know, going to the events. If there are no events in your neighborhood, plan the events. You want to get your neighbors knowing that you are the master of real estate in that neighborhood. Maybe it is, you know, that you're going to drop off, you know, some, I don't know, it's never been my thing, but you're going to drop off pumpkins because there's 50 homes in your neighborhood and you're going to do 50 pumpkins that year with your name. Well, then make sure you follow up on that, you know, and say, hey, did you get the pumpkin? Did you enjoy it? You know, I'm here for you if you need me. Get them knowing who you are and calling them once a quarter. I have agents that have dominated their neighborhood by selling 18 to 20 homes a year just in their subdivision because they became, you know, the master of their subdivision. So you can do that. Focus on your own hood. You can do expireds. You could do FSBOs. You could do circle prospecting. Again, if you just love a certain neighborhood by your area and you know that the average home that sells is, you know, 300, let's say, and there's quick turnover, start calling in there. You know, get involved in different groups. It's just kind of, for me, it was always FSBO and expired because they were the lowest hanging fruit and they were free, you know, practically other than a dialer. So I wanted the cheapest leads first, but then the cheapest leads are also the highest skill level. So you have to be open to getting more skilled in calling an expired because God forbid they might be mad at you. But if you could just get over those first 30 seconds of the call and just get in and get them talking, they're yours. So that was, for me, the mastery. I wanted to go for the fastest turnaround that I could.
Yeah. No, I love that. And, you know, the other element that we've always added in is that, you know, we get those listings where, you know, market to them, but also, you know, structure the open house correctly to be able to,
yes,
you know, drive some traffic through the door as well.
Yeah. I mean, open houses, I hadn't done open houses for the last 9 of the last 11 years. Because it was just me and a couple people on our team. And I would have, you know, 20 listings at a time and I couldn't promise us all to be there. So right. I told sellers they didn't work because I didn't have enough manpower for them. Now I do. And we definitely do them. And I mean, we just wrote a contract on a $1.3 million house. The lady wrote the contract at the open house. So it definitely works. If you get belly to belly with people, you're even stronger. And so if you're definitely want to avoid the phone because of rejection, well, then get your butt over to an open house. And if you don't have listings, there are probably 3 or 4 top producers at every office that would allow you to hold their listings open because they also don't want to do it. So there is, to me, no excuse if you have persistence. And I think most people innately are passive by nature. We don't want to be, you know, we don't want to make people feel uncomfortable. So if we can master persistence and get through being average, which I think I read a stat and it said most average salespeople stop at one attempt. Above average people will actually reach out 3 times. And then, you know, it's between call 5 and 12 that you're actually making an appointment. So why do we stop at 1?
Right. Yeah. Substitute the, hey, we made that call, right? And on to the next.
And then we're going, well, I made the call. I left a message. Why aren't they calling me back? Well, it's not their job to call you back.
Right.
They're not looking for your service. You're trying to sell them your value. Therefore, you should be hunting them down. And just like salespeople hunt me down when they want to sell me every shiny object. But, you know, sometimes I'm ready and I buy, and other times I politely say no. And it's okay.
What are all the ways, right? And, you know, everybody has their own preferred method of communication. And, you know, like, you're not going to get me on the phone, but
no.
You hit me on text, you know,
yeah,
I
yeah.
respond to you, right? So it's like you and I were able to connect via Facebook, right? Exactly. So it's like you have to find everybody's preferred method of communication. And that's why what are all the ways, and not stop at just a call and leave a voicemail and expect somebody to call you back. They're never going to call you back. So
they're never going to call you back. And, you know, and you could call somebody one time and they're just having a crappy day and they're mean to you and that's it. There goes your whole day. And it's like, my God, you could call somebody. I've called somebody 12 times and they finally answer, go, you know, I've been meaning to call you back. Thanks for reaching out. You just don't know. But if you're not calling or you're not doing anything where you're going to get in front of another human, just get out of the business.
Right.
I mean, you know, that's the reality. We have to be a little bit persistent in a business that's inundated with other salespeople. But in, you know, there's always that 80-20 rule in every business. So work on your persistence and therefore, you know, you'll just have more success and luck.
Yeah, absolutely. And you made a great point there that can be carried over into anything. Right? You know, what else could it mean? And just because you can't get a hold of them or they don't return your calls or whatever. And it's like, don't have the mindset, oh, they're rejected. They don't want to talk to me. It's just,
what else could it mean? Tell ourselves. Yeah, it's just that story. Oh, they must think I'm so annoying, you know, or whatever we tell ourselves. And I've told myself those things so I can really say it's ridiculous. And I think if we can get better at, you know what, I'm gonna make some calls today. Everybody that answers is just gonna be excited and enthusiastic to speak to me. I feel better saying that, even though there's a little piece of me that goes, well, that might not be true, but that's better than saying, oh my God, I dread these calls and people are just so rude and they're gonna be annoyed with me. I mean, imagine starting that process with that mindset versus you know, the other.
Yeah. I mean, you have a choice, the story you get to tell yourself, and might as well tell an empowering story versus a disempowering story.
Exactly. Cause they're all stories at the end of the day.
That's it. That's it. No, it's a great point. No, that's fantastic. So right now with the team structure of how you guys have everything, you said about 10 team members, is everybody listing focus? Is it buyer agent? Is it, how do you guys have it structured?
So we have some newer agents in our office that, you know, we're kind of just helping, you know, get listings at this point, but we really want them to focus on buyers because I think to be a great listing agent, you also should know the market and you should, if you're newer, there's nothing better than driving around than previewing property. You know, so if you're doing prospecting in the morning, you know, you should go out and maybe preview property in the afternoon. So, you know, if you do get a prospect that calls in a neighbor and you're like, gosh, there's 3 homes in that neighborhood for sale, I've been through them all, you immediately are professional, you know, and you know the details of it. So yeah, I think that they definitely need to, you know, do a little bit more of that.
Yeah, no, it's, that's a great point there. And it is, right? I always joke with the story with, we hired my dad to be a courier for us 1 year, and my dad was about 60 at the time, and he lived in the town his whole life. And this was back in the Garmin days. And I said, he came in there and he said, hey, I'm going to be out. I'll be back in a couple hours. I kind of looked at his list. I said, you got your old Garmin with you?
Mm-hmm.
And he laughed and he said, no, I don't need that thing. He goes, I know this town like the back of my hand. And I was like, all right, I'll see you in about 4 hours, 5 hours.
That's right.
Sure enough, he came back. He's like, man, I don't even know where half of these roads are. So he never went without the Garmin again. But just that story to your point is like, you've got to get out. You've got to know the product. You've got to know the inventory. You got to walk through it.
Yeah. If you're going to do listings, you know, at a high level. And again, I think it's just so hard when you're new, you don't know the area very well, or you don't know what you need to know. I mean, go shadow people. I called like some of the top agents in our area and I just said, hey, could I buy you lunch and show me around this town? Because, you know, every town has their own lingo. You know, on that side of the tracks is this. I mean, you want to know what the locals know. And for me, it was all new. If you grew up in your, you know, and you're living and playing in your same town, great. I mean, you have such an advantage. So you know where everything is. For our team right now, we have 2 or 3 like kind of where I feel that they'll be groomed for listing agent, they'll take over my listings. And so we're getting there. But I think that if you say no to, nobody can list except these 3 people, everybody will want to. I think the reality is some people are just gonna fall into buyer agency and they're gonna enjoy buyers more, and others are gonna enjoy listings. And what I tell all my listing agents is if you don't like confrontation, you're not going to be a great listing agent. And so I find that teachers make great listing agents because they're always being confronted by parents, you know, and their prized possession is their child. And they have to figure out how to be, you know, how to, you know, just be a politician when they're talking about all these different kids. And so, yeah, I think that if you're going to go into listings, you A, have to learn what to say, and B, you have to know that you're going to be in front of a seller, and it's going to be, unfortunately, sometimes a little bit combative. You know, what are you doing to sell my home? Why aren't you marketing it as much? You know, if you don't know the answers to all those questions, it's going to be a hard process.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think too, you know, as you understand the value that you bring, that's also too, right? The mindset, the belief that you have the solution to help them accomplish whatever it is that they want to accomplish.
Right.
And I've seen that with teachers as well, right? You know, they genuinely will try to understand what it is that you're wanting to accomplish. And then, you know, they have, like you said, the savvy to be able to communicate that, oh, I can help you do that, and here's how we're going to do it.
Exactly.
And one of our top agents, when we were in the Lawton office, she was a retired school teacher. She just crushed it.
Yeah. And I mean, again, it's, I never claimed to be the smartest person in the room. I was a BC student. I just, when I got scripts in my hand, it was like, oh my God, somebody's giving me the confidence. And so, you know, now I can articulate to a seller, you know, what I need to articulate, and I can be the professional that they're looking for versus just winging it and saying, oh, wow, you play golf, I play golf. Wow, your house is so pretty. I mean, that's great. But at the end of the day, let's get down to business. Let's be on point and make them feel like they're about to hire somebody who's going to get the job done.
Yeah, you made a couple other points a second ago about, you know, if you're in need of listings and you want to hold it open. I mean, the EXP network is growing at such an exponential rate that there's probably EXP agents in your marketplace that have listings that would love for you to hold them open, and vice versa.
Absolutely.
If you've got listings that you want them, you know, reach out to them. We've got, you know, other clients, other, you know, honey badgers that are in other markets that reach out to other EXP agents to hold their homes open for them. So don't let that be a constraint or an excuse.
Yeah, absolutely. And door knock around those opens, you know, just go invite all the neighbors. And, you know, when they see that listing and then it sells and you've now touched the neighbors once to invite them to an open, or once to call them and say, hey, we just listed this home. It's, you know, 3-bedroom, 3-bath for, you know, $350,000. And then the home immediately sells in a week or two, and you call that exact same list. You say, hey, it's Tina Call. I just want to let you know, we just sold that home. And they're like, wow, it sold quick. Yep. And we know when one home sells, another one sells right away. So who do you know that might be thinking of selling? Because we have leftover buyers. It's just such a neat way to kind of have, you know, that immediate touch with these people. And you're going to get calls from that. There's usually, we get a listing every time we sell a listing, almost immediately.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you guys are being proactive around it as well, right? So that's the lesson. And you're being proactive and you're having the conversations, and you know, you're being, you know, like I said, proactive in the calendar, the time is allocated, you know, you're scripted, you know what you're going to say, you know what the objective is, and you guys just execute.
And the thing about it is, John, too, don't get me wrong, we are not perfect. I mean, every day we have to build our people's mindset, yep, and get back in there and go, guys, you can do it. I mean, it's not like this perfect machine. If you walk in, we're all going through the same struggles, but if we fail a little faster, you know, fail forward faster, then our people will win, you know? And so I think that's the neat thing is on our team, our average agent can sell, you know, 24 homes, and, you know, the average in our area, if you're not on a team, is 2 to 4. So they're winning. And then we have some agents on our team that'll do 50 deals this year. And eventually, the neat thing with EXP is eventually, if they do want to grow off the team, you know, they can now continue to grow and grow their own teams, and we'll all be in business together. But it's just, you know, I think it's just fact. If you're surrounding yourself with a group of people that all have the same goals, it's just going to be easier. So if I were an EXP agent in another city and there were a couple other EXP agents that wanted to do bigger things, prospect together. There's enough business for everyone, I promise you. And sometimes I would get a lead on the phone. I wouldn't get the appointment, and Kevin would get it like literally 4 minutes after I hung up. So we both are in the same room. we both just, you know, talked to the same person, but that person resonated more with Kevin. And so same thing. I mean, don't feel like you have to do it on your own. Just do it with a partner, a team, and do it 3 days a week to start. Do it once a week to start, and then twice, and then three times. You don't have to be like out the gate 5 days a week, 3 hours a day. You're not going to do it. So I would be proud of a new person if they just said, damn it, for 1 hour a day, I'm going to do something that makes me really uncomfortable, and I'm going to do it 3 days a week. Well, that's a win. And then next week, do it again and again. And then month two, add in another day or maybe add another hour. But do something. Little baby chunks will get you there.
Build on it. Yeah, okay? Build on it. And I would say anybody listening in that if you're like, oh, well, I don't have a team, I'm not in an office. So what? If you're working from the house, connect with somebody in the Honey Badger network, connect with another EXP agent in your marketplace, get that accountability partner. And, you know, you guys have each other on an accountability piece and being able to bounce off of each other. And you could do it virtual. You don't even have to do it. You don't even have to be in the same office.
Actually, you could do a Zoom conference call where you mute everything and you watch each other and you know that you're in your room, wherever that is. I used to work from home. I actually preferred it because it was less distractions. So yeah, I mean, hold each other accountable. Get a group of three of you from other states and do a Zoom call and say, okay, guys, we're going to do this 3 days a week. I mean, there should be Honey Badgers that post after this, hey, I'm looking for role play partners Monday, Wednesday, Friday at this time. And you guys should all interact that way and hold each other accountable and learn your scripts. I'm happy to send anybody our scripts. They are not mine. They are wherever we got them in the last 10 years. They've been morphed into whatever they are today.
They do morph, right? And then you pick up a little from over here, a little over here.
That's right.
So it's fantastic. I do want to emphasize the thing that you mentioned about, you know, if you're new, And I use this for another reason, right? The duality of reaching out to people that are more experienced and established in the marketplace for their guidance. You will be amazed at how people will respond when you ask them for their mentorship, their guidance. Yes. Could you help me? Like, they will help.
They will help. They're happy to help.
They are happy to help. But it also, being at EXP, if they're not a part of EXP, it could get your foot in the door to possibly have a conversation or get them to somebody that can, you know, maybe help them see the bigger picture. So I just want to emphasize that. Don't be afraid to reach out and ask, because they will say yes for their, you know, for the mentorship and guidance. I would not reach out to talk about EXP. I would reach out to talk about,
yes, do not do that,
about my career. Yes.
That's right. But I think that's the same mental game in our head. They're not going to want to talk to me. They're that, you know, that mega agent. No, that's not true. It's just nobody reaches out to ask you a question ever. I have a few groups in the area that will, you know, ask me to jump in on some mastermind calls, and I'm happy to do it. But if you don't call, you never know. So
that's right. All the time. What do you do with the team as far as getting connected and getting it out into the community? You guys kind of, you know, encourage certain groups, certain things to be affiliated with. What do you guys do in that regard to be plugged in?
So, I mean, as far as plugging in, I mean, we do like our own company client appreciation events. I can't say that we've done a ton in the community. I mean, I've only been at EXP since April. You know, before that we were with KW and we did the Red Day and we did other things. So sure, we're going to try to do more events, you know, for the community as we kind of settle in now, which I feel like we finally, you know, are settled in. So yeah, I don't think, but we're not doing a ton, unfortunately, right now.
Yeah, definitely be able to build upon. I know, you know, just seeing the whole mindset shift from, man, I don't want to hang out with those AFAs. I don't want to hang out with those type of agents. I'm not going to go to those events. And then, you know, you start to see, well, you know, I need to be where the, you know, getting plugged in on those type of events, and you start to see it. And, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, you are the brand, and, you know, you got to get out and create the collisions in the marketplace. And it just kind of tied back to what you were saying about the community, right? In your own neighborhood. And if your community doesn't have community events, you be the one to have those events.
Right, really, right.
To be able to create those collisions.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we do try to get involved and go to events that are happening. We don't put them on ourselves, I guess was my point. But I mean, maybe eventually we'll do more. again, I just, my operations manager is actually really good at kind of putting that together. And so it's kind of a new venture for us to have a team as large as we have. So now we're really hyper-focused on them and having our presence here in Cary, because we do have the number one team in Cary, which is nice. We're doing a lot of marketing now that we have marketing dollars to spend. You know, we're doing print advertising. We never used to do that. I mean, my marketing budget was zero. I never bought Zillow leads before. But as you start growing as a company and you have extra money, you can start, you know, doing some things like that. So
I'm curious, and I know we're bouncing around here a little bit, but it's just, you're just sparking as we're having this conversation. That year that you guys made the jump, you broke through the 50, and then you made the jump to 100. What were kind of the next steps that propelled you guys to make that leap?
It was interesting because my coach would say, trust me, 50 to 100, 100 is just as easy as 50. And I never believed her. I'm like, I'm freaking out at 50. And how could 100 be easier? But it's true. It is easier.
It is. Because
you, the systems are already in place. The habits are already in place. So I know exactly what I need to do to get to 50. All I'm doing at that point is just adding in maybe a few more calls, a few more contacts. So I'm being more efficient at that point. And so as the efficiency grows, you're making more money because you're adding two or three more deals a month. And then that extra money allows you to buy leverage and hire more staff. And so you go from your personal assistant that does everything to now you have a listing, a seller side listing coordinator and a buyer side listing coordinator. So you can divvy those chores up. So really more getting to 100 affords you more money, which affords you more leverage. And therefore nothing really changes other than, you know, you're more hyper-focused on, hey, instead of making, you know, an appointment a day, I'm going to try to make two a day. And that's going to be my goal now, because now I'm a better agent and I can do more. So it was just adding more deals for me.
Right.
And I actually was less busy at 130 transactions than I am today running a team. I mean, I really thought that the grass was going to be greener growing a team. I was golfing Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays when I sold 130 homes, and then I had two buyer agents, we did 180 deals. I had two admin, my husband, me, and two buyer agents, and we had the life. But I didn't realize it at the time. I was like, I'm so busy, and there's got to be a better way. And I'm like, that's it. We're going to grow a team. Well, now I've golfed, I think, 5 times this year. So,
yeah.
So I think that's the sweet spot for me is two buyer agents, lead listing agent, and then you can exit the business. Like if I would have gone back, but then, you know, you don't have the experience that you have to draw back on. So I would never change the trajectory and the path.
Right.
I love being in a position where now I have to step up and be a leader. I never had to do that. I didn't lead my two buyer agents. We just kind of all had fun together.
Yeah, and had fun.
Yeah. But now it's like, okay, oh shit, we got to have a meeting. What are we going to talk about? What are we going to teach people? So it kind of bumps you up to a different level. And I'm still learning every day. I'm not.
Absolutely. Staying a student and what happens and just for everybody listening in, what happened, Tina just shared with you guys is that the game changed, right? At 5, you're having fun. You're playing checkers. And you increase up over 5, you get to 10 to 15. The board stays the same, but the pieces change and the game changes. Now you're playing chess.
Yes.
And, you know, you think about the pieces of on the chessboard, everybody is a little more specialized.
Right.
Whereas on the checkers, everybody can move every which way, they can jump over everybody. You're just having fun.
Yeah.
And so when, you know, Tina made that leap, the game changed. She's, you know, she's leading, she's being more strategic, she's playing a different game. And it's just the natural progression. It's super cool.
Yeah. And people, you know, they'll go, gosh, you know, you run this big team and your overhead must be crazy. And it's like, well, it is, but it gradually got to that point. You know,
right.
I didn't say I'm going to start, you know, in a new town, I'm going to hire 10 agents and staff and, you know, have 50 grand a month in overhead. Like who does that? Nobody.
Right.
So as the business grows and you're spending 2 grand and then 4 grand and then, but then your deals are, you know, are growing and you've got the budget to do it. So that's why I always chuckle when people are like, oh, I'm going to grow a team. I'm like, you sell 20 homes. Like what team are you growing? You know, right now you need to figure out how to sell more homes and become a leader and then more efficient But I think people look for that easy way out. I'm just going to grow a team. Okay, well, good luck with that. I think it's really challenging to go from selling 10 deals a year to growing a team. In essence, you're just saying, I want to start a brokerage.
Right.
You know?
Right.
I mean, now I guess with EXP, you could grow a team and not have to do as much. But if you're still, again, those people have to be led and nurtured, and it's not just easy breezy.
Right, for sure. No, I think a couple key takeaways just to kind of emphasize, and it goes back to that point right there, and you said it right in the beginning, is embrace the boredom, right? Stay consistent, and you know, there has to be a high level of discipline in there, and we all need that additional accountability. So find that accountability partner that's going to hold you to what it is that you say you want to do, and just patiently urgent is kind of the way we look at it.
Or then pay someone $1,000 a month and then don't do what they say. I mean, that's, you know, that's called coaching. And a lot of people say, oh, I can't afford a coach. You can't afford not to have a coach. The only thing the coach did for me was give me accountability. And if they said, hey, did you do what you said? And you're like, no, I didn't. Well, if you do that for 3 weeks straight, they're not easy conversations. So I think that's the thing that you got to look at is you need to have accountability. And if it's just a friend that's going to let things slide, that's not the right partner.
That's right. Absolutely. Yeah. Tina, amazing. Thank you for taking the time. I know you're super, super busy and bouncing around and running in, and really, really appreciate you adding tons and tons of value to the Honey Badger Nation. Any final words? And also, how can people get in touch with you?
They can go to tina@callteam.com is my email address. Like I said, if you guys want scripts or whatever, we're happy to help and shoot those out for people. But I would just say, like, you know, if you're newer or 1 to 2 years in the business, it is just learn what to say and you won't be afraid to get in front of more people. I don't care how you get in front of them. Just know that you've got to get in front of them and you got to learn persistence. And so be pleasantly persistent and it will it'll do good by you.
Well said. Thank you again so much, and appreciate all you guys, and we'll see you guys on the next episode.
Thanks so much. See ya.